Welcome. Let's discuss about the highlights for the January 2020 edition of Yojana, and that focuses on the issue of environment. So some of the most important issues that have been addressed in this edition are mainly Kayakalp, and then you have sustainable sanitation in the cities. You have discussion on the Convention on Climate Change. The COP25 recently took place at Madrid, Spain. Then you have the guidelines for the Kayakalp, which we would be discussing a minute later. And then the Swachh Survekshan mission, the monitoring with W sharp, again very, very important for your 2020 examination this time. The role of community radio in disaster management. So we are definitely heading ahead with India's effort under the Convention for Climate Change that was held, the COP25 that was held at Madrid in 2019. India has reduced the emission intensity of the idea to achieve the goals that have been set of the 175 gigawatt that are the targets for the renewable energy. We have so far achieved 83 gigawatts. And then we are also talking about a commercial operation of 100% biofuel flight that would be operated, and most of the flights by 2030 would have 20% blending with ethanol. We are moving from BS4 to BS6 norms, so that is again a important issue. The next is the LED scheme, the Ujjwala Yojana, through which we are trying to move from the CFL to the LED lightnings. We are also focusing on e-vehicles. Initially, the cost has been higher, but slowly and gradually with development, we see that e-vehicles would be much more cost efficient as compared to the other vehicles that would be in the market. We are also trying to create more of carbon sink. So creating a sink of nearly 2.5 to 3 billion tons of carbon equivalent is important. Now under COP25, what are the outcomes that we have focused on? First is the negotiation relating to Article 6 of the Paris Agreement. We are trying to develop our full capacity for technological development and support to the other developing nations. We are trying to interpret the provisions of the Paris Agreement and a kind of two-year program to assess the pre-2020 progress has been mandated this time. Kayakalp, as we said, is a new scheme by the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare that started back in 2015. The idea was to maintain good infrastructure along with good sanitation, hygiene, public services and control of the infections. So government institutions and public facilities have been the major areas where this has been done. Now Swachh Bharat Abhiyan or Clean India Mission was one of the missions that aimed to eradicate the open defecation in India. There had been a lot of efforts in this line. Kayakalp initiative has been doing really successful. You have other apps like Mera Hospital, which is a kind of patient feedback system for the government hospitals and the district hospitals. You are also trying to bring in policies for the district hospitals and more updates on those. Three of the best PHCs that have been part of the Kayakalp fall in the regions of Andhra Pradesh, Gujarat and Karnataka, and they have been facilitated by the Ministry of Jal Shakti. So again important. Now talking about the sustainable sanitation in the cities, 2011 census reveals that only 12.6% of the households have open defecation, were practicing open defecation, and this number has been over the years significantly reduced. Now we are also talking about the implementation of the various schemes like AMRUT scheme, smart city scheme. We are talking about Swachh Bharat urban and rural versions. So we have covered separate lectures for these topics, so just go back and check up those lectures. We are also talking about a sustaining urban sanitation scheme through the AMRUT mission, and the septage and the sewerage management system has been updated in this line. Swachh Survekshan is a survey conducted by Ministry of Housing and Urban Affairs, and this talks about checking the ranks of the various cities based on the sanitation and cleanliness parameters. So you had various rounds that have been done. Indore has been declared as one of the cleanest cities, and then you have further issues, mainly the manual scavenging and hazardous entry that have been taken into account for the sweepers and the people engaged engaged with the sanitation services. We are also trying to have an online management information systems where real-time data capturing could be done. Citizens' engagement is much more important, and we are trying to create brand ambassadors who can bring up behavioral change in the mindset of a common people. Talking about water management, very, very important project is W-Sharp. It is a women-led water sanitation, hygiene and resilient practices project. Now, this is a community project that was started from the region of Marathwada, and you had an idea to enhance the livelihood, water and food security for nearly 100 villages in those areas, mainly in the two drought-prone blocks of Maharashtra. So this project, along with the local government, the state government and the central government, has been working hard, and 50 villages from each of the blocks have been working on community participation. You have Arogya Sakhis, which are the health friends that have been called so far. And then you have the tools for service providers such as Ashas and Anganwadi workers who have been working in line with those. Water budgeting is another important idea where the requirement of the overall household for water is taken into account based on the number of family members, based on the consumption areas and the reuse potential for the water. Then you also have a kind of gender responsive systems for drought prone areas, and the next important is fluorosis. Now fluorosis has been a major issue in the regions of Rajasthan, mainly the South Rajasthan, the regions of Dungarpur, Banswara and Bhilwara. Now here fluorosis is a disease where the prescribed limit, we say, is 1.5 parts per million, and prolonged exposure beyond that could create severe diseases. Those could be affecting the joint movements, it could be creating the dental problems and also affecting the vegetative state. So problem of fluorosis has been very severe in the regions of Rajasthan, mainly the South Rajasthan. As we said, the pilot project of Dungarpur that took place in 2018, which was a kind of people-centric district and a people-centered priority that was taken into account here. You had a lot of development that has been going, mainly changing or exposing people to the behavioral practices and the dietary restrictions that they should follow. The next is creating India which is ODF free, and then we are aiming at changing the behavioral patterns of the people. The next is the role of community radio in disaster management. As we said, this is again one of the very, very important aspects because we are focusing on more participation in involvement and ownership of a common people. You have various community radio stations which are broadcasting educational programs. They are talking about the radio development programs being used in other nations, for example, Nepal, Bangladesh, and they have been a popular means of engaging people even in developed countries like Canada. So definitely, how does it benefit? So it speaks in the local language. You have a two-way interaction through social learning. You also have the local knowledge and local needs and demands that could be fulfilled. And sometimes you have good governance that could be brought about with the help of community radio. Especially in the pre-disaster and post-disaster period, you have the rehabilitation, the rescue efforts that could be brought into account. The next is mitigation of carbon footprint. Now, carbon footprint has been one of the major issues, not across India but across the globe. Now what happens is the land use, land cover that we talk about as LULC changes are very, very important. So we are aiming at large scale implementation of renewable and sustainable energy alternatives that are seen mainly in the ecological sensitive areas of Western Ghats. Now here, due to carbon global warming, there has been a lot of carbon sequestration, and as a result you have higher emissions that are seen in the regions of Western Ghat. Western Ghat is one of the biological hotspots, and over the years we have seen that by 2031 only 10% of the evergreen forest would remain in the Western Ghats, and that would significantly affect the livelihood as well as the natural climate system of the Western Ghats. So what needs to be taken into account as of now is reducing the anthropogenic pressure on the Western Ghats. And when we talk about carbon footprint, where it is actually coming from is again important. So energy sector is the highest game player here, followed by agriculture, industry and land use changes. So this could be a kind of very direct question, the proportion of contribution towards carbon footprint, which of those is the highest proportion or which of those is the lowest proportion. The next is the concept of decarbonization. Decarbonization can be brought about through stringent practices, strict norms, mainly in the ecological fragile areas, and we are also focusing on a polluter pay principle. Now, we have discussed about polluter pay principle in our separate class on carbon trading. Very, very important. Based on the upcoming kind of questions that are asked, carbon sequestration, carbon trading, polluter's pay principle have been very, very important for your examination perspective. The next is emerging civil society's initiative in agriculture. So there have been constant innovations in the agriculture. There is a shift from food security to nutritional security, where we talk about Poshan Abhiyan. Okay, we are also talking about micro millets and millets. So 2018 was declared as a national year for millets. Now, sometimes we are moving towards dense food crops, which are mainly the smaller millets and pulses, and they are also known as orphan crops. So, decade of action on nutrition, which has been declared for 2016 to 25, as per the sustainable development goals of UN, have been important. The next is the electronic waste. Now, electronic waste is one of the major concerns. We usually divide or classify the goods under three heads: white goods, brown goods, and gray goods. White goods are the clean goods, which are the household appliances. Brown goods are TVs, cameras, camcorders. However, gray goods are the computers, computer peripheral parts, printers, and so on. So gray goods, it's believed that it is twice as toxic as the white and the brown goods that are there. Now, whatever waste is generated from the electronic component is classified under e-waste. Now, dumping of a e-waste is again a very, very major question, because you have some of the most dangerous compounds that could be seen as lead, cadmium, mercury, you have PVC, then you have flame retardants that are usually seen. And disposal of e-waste is again one of the major concerns. Now, lead is mainly seen in the acid batteries, cathode ray tubes. You have cadmium, which is seen in battery, cathode ray tubes, housing. Mercury is seen mainly in the switches, filaments. Then you have chromium, that is seen with decorative hardeners. That is one of the major things where you have a higher amount of chromium 6 that could be released, and then also in the corrosion protection agents that are seen. The next important thing that we need to understand is the amendment rules for 2018 for e-waste management in India. So there has been a phase-wise collection of e-waste, which shall be 10% of the quantity of the waste that has been generated in terms of electronic waste. You also have the PRO, which is the producer responsibility organizations, that should apply to the Central Pollution Control Board for the registration of the various activities. And under the reduction of hazardous substance provisions, the cost of the sampling and the testing shall be taken care by the government itself. Now, only 1.5% of the total e-waste generated in India is recycled. The major reason being lack of awareness, no proper segregation of the e-waste and the other waste in the country. So when we talk about development and environment, it's very, very important that there is a fine balance between the two, because if we are moving towards development, definitely it would be at the cost of environment, but at what cost is really important. So checking out the carbon footprint, checking out the plastic pollutions into the oceans, taking care of the electronic waste, the fossil fuels, the burning of the fossil fuels have been important. Again, we also have a national level strategy to achieve 20 to 30% reduction in the particulate matter 20, particulate matter 10 and 2.5 by 2024. We are also talking about the intended nationally determined contribution for 175 gigawatts of renewable energy that we have already discussed, and that's by 2030. Plastic waste, as I said, has been next major issue. Now, how this plastic waste could be used? Plastic waste could be categorized as hard foam, soft foam. It could be in the form of laminated plastics, in the forms of films, carry bags, or any other thing. But it has been highly used in the road and the highway construction, especially by the national highways within 50 kilometer periphery of the urban area, or with a population of 5 lakh or more. Similarly, recycling plastic out of the landfills for building the roads has been important. A National Rural Roads Development Agency has also taken up the following guidelines for the same. The Central Research Institute for the Road Management has said that the shredded waste plastic should pass through 3 millimeters of sieve, and it could be through the 4.75 millimeters of sieve and retain only 1 mm of that, then it indicates that it would be highly used for the road construction purposes. So under the road laying, we are also seeing that along with the plastic waste, you have bitumen that has been mixed, and this creates a kind of smooth and environment friendly road. We are also talking about one of the important marks for the National Voters Day 2020, and that is electoral literacy for a stronger democracy. So since 2011, we are marking the Election Commission of India that was established back in 1950. So National Voters Day is celebrated in line with that. Year-wise, you had the themes for this. So in 2011, it was greater participation for stronger democracy. However, in 2020, we have the theme electoral literacy for a stronger democracy. So literacy is definitely a very important concept that has been focused this year. The next is the construction of the tiger corridors. There has been a threefold strategy. First is a logistic support, the next is restricting the habitat, and third is talking about a operating procedure for the same in case there is emergency, in case there is need for the rehabilitation of the tigers, the sick tigers that are there, and this would impact the overall ecosystem. So those have been some of the major issues that we have discussed in the Yojana edition for 2020 January. We'll be covering up many more issues in our upcoming sessions. So stay subscribed. Have a wonderful evening.